Well, happy Thanksgiving Eve, AARC, to those of you who are here with us in person, to those of you joining us online. We're so glad you could come here together tonight to join us in worship. And I mentioned a few weeks ago that it seems so weird to think that Thanksgiving is only just a few weeks away. I'm not gonna lie, it hasn't gotten any less weird. Like, we were starting to get some things. I put a turkey in the roaster before coming here tonight. It still doesn't seem right that Thanksgiving is tomorrow. But then I thought about this. We spent so much time this year thinking about all the things that we've missed, all the things that have been disappointments, all the things that have been frustration. Doesn't it just feel really good to think about stuff that we're thankful for and that we're grateful for, that we can praise God for, instead of focusing on all the other stuff that's happened this year? So I want to share these words from Psalm 100 to kind of focus our minds and our hearts as we enter into worship tonight. They say this: shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. I want to focus on that last verse for just a minute. This has just been such a year filled with uncertainty in terms of wondering about what's going to happen in the next week or the next month, what events are going to happen, what isn't going to happen, what plans are going to have to change. We've all had to adjust in so many ways throughout this year. But I want you to hear verse 5 again. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. As I think about this year, one of the things that I can see so clearly is that the Lord has been faithful through this year in a lot of ways. Yes, there have been lots of disappointments. Yes, there's been lots of things that have been difficult along the way. But the Lord has been faithful, and he's been good. So would you join me in prayer as we enter into worship to our loving God tonight? God, we thank you for the opportunity to worship. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, for your goodness, for your kindness, Lord, as we come into this season, God, of Thanksgiving, of remembering all these things that we have to give thanks for, God. May we be thankful for you, for who you are, for your love, for your grace, for your kindness, for your goodness. And God, as we worship you tonight, may our hearts be filled with praise to you, and may you receive honor and glory through our worship tonight. Let's pray this all in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. So for songs this evening, we're going to be using the hymnals that are in the racks in front of you, the green books, so you can turn to the first one at this time. Would you stand and join us in singing?
You can be seated. You know, we come here on Thanksgiving, and I'm sure every single one of us, there's different things that we're thankful for. You may be thankful for a home. You may be thankful for the food or a good job or that promotion or maybe the person sitting next to you. But tonight I want to challenge us to maybe think a little bit deeper. I want us to think about something eternal. I want us to think about the works that God has done in your life. If I were to ask you, what is something that God has done in your life this past year? Because there's no price you can put on that. The things that God has done, I pray that they're embedded through and through in your life. And so we're going to watch a video that we put together as Movement, just talking about what we're thankful for this year. And then after that, we're going to continue in our worship.
Thank you.
there's no way I'm going to preach all the way up there. It's too high. All right. Let's open up in prayer. God, we come before you, and God, we just ask, God, that our hearts would just be open to receive what you have for us tonight. God, that you would speak to us. But God, if there's people in here who are lost, broken, lonely, God, that tonight would be a night that you can radically change their life forever. God, and we know that's your heart's desire, to grab a hold of a person and to change them. And so we ask, God, that from the balcony, from the left to the right, up to the front, that God, tonight, that you would speak to every single one of us, and that we would truly understand what it means to be thankful. And we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, when we were making that video, to me, it was exciting to see just the testimonies of some of our young people and really what God has been doing in the hearts of some of our students. And I'm not going to lie, there was a lot of times where they would flip over the card while I was videoing it, and I just had to hold back tears from crying like a baby, just because I am always in awe of what God does. And it, may I never ever lose just that desire to see God work in people's life, and never ever just take it casually when I see God get a hold of someone, no matter what their life looks like, and get a hold of them and change and transform them. Because there's no person in this room, no person, there is no exception, there's no one in this room that deserves God to affect our lives. But nevertheless, he chooses to work in our lives. And so tonight, what I want to talk about is what I'm the most thankful for. What I'm the most thankful for. There's a lot of things that I'm really, really thankful for. I look at my life and I feel like I have a really, really good life. I have an incredible wife. I have great kids. I'm part of a great church. I have students that I'm seeing God move in their lives. I'm a part of a great team here on staff. I have great friends. Our bills are paid. I mean, God has really, really, really blessed us. But the truth is that at any moment, those things could be taken away from me. At some point, there will be a day where maybe some of those things will no longer be a part of my life. And so I always try to keep things in perspective. I always try to hold on to things loosely. But there is something that I hold on to so, so tightly. And I think I'm even discovering it more and more as the older I get and the more time that I spend with God and the more I pursue him, I understand what it really, really means to be thankful. And in Luke 15, we see this story of the prodigal son. We see this story, and what he had it all. He had it made. A life of luxury. But he had his own intentions, his own ideas of how he thought his life should look. And the prodigal son leaves the father's home, and he finds himself just sitting in a mess. Has squandered everything, has nothing left, and he's begging, and he's dirty. And here's where we pick up in Luke 15, chapter verse 17. Here's what it says. And when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and I will go back to my father and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" He was willing to move down in ranks and not even be considered part of the family anymore. So he got up, he went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, the father saw him in the distance and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against you, against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." And here's the part that I want us to lean into. here's the part where I really, really want us to focus in on. It's verse 22 through 24. Here's what it says. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive and again. He was lost and is now found. So they began to celebrate. What a beautiful picture this parable is of God's forgiveness. But when I think about that story, we have to understand this, that every single one of us are like that son. It is our natural desire, it's our natural tendency to want to take over the reins of our lives. And the place and the priority that God should take in our lives, we try so hard to try to fill that with other things. It might be school, it might be job, it might be money, it might be family, it might be ourselves. We try to find things to take that position that God is supposed to take. And it's just our natural tendency to do that. Without God intervening in our life, we are helpless. There is not an exception to the rule. If we just sit back and let life hit us, this is where we find ourselves. We find ourselves trying to chase things, trying to find purpose, and we can only really find it in Christ. We are like that son. We find out that we're chasing things, trying to find purpose, but we only find that purpose coming to the Father. And just like that prodigal son, we find out that no matter where we're at, no matter what we've done, he welcomes us with open arms. How beautiful is that? If I'm thankful for anything, at the highest of my list is God's forgiveness. Because it changed me. It just didn't make me a better person. It just didn't add value to my life. It changed me. Having a true encounter with God and experiencing that forgiveness is a life-changing experience. And maybe you're here today and you look back at your life and you can't look at yourself and maybe ever say, well, I was never really in that place. I never really, really hit rock bottom. I was never really down and out. I've never really lived a crazy life. I don't really know where I've made that choice, but I know that I'm forgiven. Regardless of your past, understand that your future is ahead of you and God continues to pour out his blessings because of one thing, because of his forgiveness. That forgiveness is a game changer. It gives us access to this incredible God and the plan that he has for us. So let's talk about God's forgiveness and why this is so paramount, why this is so important, and why we should constantly have this in the forefront of our mind, how good God's forgiveness is. God's forgiveness is incredible because it's for everyone, for anything, at any time. Did you hear what I said? It's for everyone, it's for anything, and it's available any time. It doesn't matter who you are. I don't care what you've done, what type of background you have, what skeletons you have in your closet. God's forgiveness is available to you, and he holds it waiting for you to accept it as a beautiful gift. Yeah. But not only is it available to anyone, it's available for anything. There is nothing you could do where God would not give you access to his forgiveness. It doesn't matter. You could be the worst of the worst. I love seeing people that were at the last straw of their life and they handed their lives over to God and forgot to see them radically transformed. Yeah. I've met gang members. I've met people that have spent a lot of times in prison. I've met drug dealers. I've met pimps and prostitutes. I've met some crazy people who have led some crazy lives just to see God pluck them out of their situation and set them on a new path. It doesn't matter what you've done, his forgiveness is available to us. And it's available at any time. There is no time where you cannot come to God and say, God, I desperately need you. There is no time where God says, I am too busy for you. I have other things to do. I have plans. Don't bother me. I love the fact that we can come to the Father at any time. His forgiveness is unconditional. But not only that, his forgiveness is complete. It's a complete work. That what he sets out to do in our life, he does it, and it starts with this idea of him forgiving us. And challenging us and moving us to new places in our lives. Romans chapter 4, I love the Message version. I love what it says here. It says this, fortunate those whose crimes are charted off, whose sins are wiped clean from the slate. Fortunate the person whom the Lord does not keep score. Aren't you happy the Lord does not keep a tally of your wrongdoings?
Yeah.
I'm so thankful that he does not hold those things against me. That when I come to God and I ask him, God, I need you to do something big. God, I need you to speak to me. I love the fact that God does not come and say, well, I would, Rob, but, I mean, remember what you did last week? Remember what you did the week before that? Remember those things you said? Remember those things you thought? Remember this and remember that? I love the fact that God remembers these things no more, and he desires to move forward in my life. How beautiful is his forgiveness? We don't deserve it, but God chooses to give it to us anyway. The truth is, you know you. You know you better than anyone else. And you know where your thoughts go. You know how easy it is to become selfish. You know how easy it is to want to do things for selfish gain. You know how easy it is to not care about people. You know how easy it is to forget about God. But I love that even in spite of all those things, God chooses to love us and extend forgiveness and grace towards our lives. But at the same, on the same hand, we need to understand that forgiveness has a cost. Jesus Christ paid the price for us. Why? Because he loves us. Because he is head over heels for you. There has never been another, and there will never be another person who loves you to the extent that God loves you. Loves you so much that he would send his son to die a criminal's death, to be beaten, to be ridiculed, for the sole purpose of paying the price for your sins, so you could experience forgiveness. And Jesus Christ went to the cross with no guarantee at all that anyone would ever accept him. No guarantee that you would ever even recognize Jesus is who he said he is, but he did it anyways. How incredible is this that God was willing to pay the cost for us? We read that story of the prodigal son, and the father gave his son a robe, a ring, sandals, and a calf as a sign of forgiveness, saying, son, it's water under the bridge. We're done with that. Let's move on. I love how God comes before us, and we come before God and say, I recognize Christ paid the price. Can you forgive me of the life that I lived? And I love how God is able to look at it and say, son, daughter, it's okay. It's water under the bridge. Let's go reach your purpose. Let's go live out the destiny. Let's go reach some people. Let's go change a world. Yeah. How exciting is that? That God is able to pick us up from these people who are so focused on ourselves. And that he's able to take us through this single act of forgiveness, of accepting who Christ is, and move us to a brand new place. What an incredible price was paid for us. Jesus was a sign of saying, I love you this much. My wife and I, we were going to my daughter's game. She's on the basketball team, and she's this close to dunking. She's almost there. But on our way there, we just started talking about God. And that's not that's the usual. So it wasn't out of the ordinary. And we were just talking about like what our devotion was that morning. We were just talking about the season of life that we're in. And I looked over at my wife and I said, babe, I said, I'm so thankful that it's normal for us to have these talks. That it's not weird. Like, it's just normal for us to want to talk about what God is showing us and doing in our lives. And I'm so thankful that I have a wife that not only pursues Christ, but is also wanting to know and introspective of what's happening inside of my life and making sure that God is moving in my life. And I know without a doubt, she's probably the person who has radically helped, been a conduit for changing my life. And the extent that this woman loves me, I will never, ever know. But I think about the love that God has for me. And as much as I know my wife loves me, it fails into comparison compared to the love that God has for me, that he would send his son to die for me. I don't care how strong of a marriage you have. I don't care how much fathers you bond with your son or mothers you bond with your daughter. Your love fails in huge comparison to the amazing love that God gives us every single day. The fact that he would want to work and move in our lives is nothing short of a miracle. And lastly, God's forgiveness. Something so miraculous, something so life-changing, something so important. We need to understand that God's forgiveness demands a response. It demands a response. Something so paramount, something so cathartic, something so life-changing, something that our lives hang in the balance of what we are going to do with this whole thing of understanding that God's forgiveness, there's a choice that has to be made. It's a call for a changed life. It's not a call to be good people. It's not a call to be nice. It's a call to be changed, to be different than this world. That's where unforgiveness leads. It's a heart that is thankful and desires to be obedient. I think I'm understanding even more now the consequences of the decisions that I make. Making sure that I have my ears tuned to what God is speaking to me. Because I have a wife that's looking to me. I have two sons. I have a daughter. I have people that I'm trying to lead outside of that group. And my desire now is to be more obedient to God than ever before. Because I know this, that if I can begin to create a desire in my life to be obedient to God, that hopefully my kids, hopefully MOVE students, hopefully movement students, hopefully people within this church will follow. I want to be obedient. Why? Because God has forgiven me. I realized it wasn't just a throwaway cost for God, but he literally bankrupted heaven, gave the very, very best he possibly could for me, for you. That demands a high price for our own lives. A life that passionately pursues God. Are you passionately pursuing God? If I were to ask you, are you forgiven? I would think that there's probably people here that would say yeah. I would probably think most of you. Maybe even all of you. But if I were to ask you, has that forgiveness, has it led to you passionately pursuing God? Has it led to a radical change in your life? Where you are so off the beaten path of the people you know? Has unforgiveness led you to that type of lifestyle? You look at the disciples. Went against the stream, against the flow, where they were constantly being persecuted for their faith. But you see, everywhere they go, their desire was to change lives. their desires to be obedient to God. They weren't so consumed with all these natural desires, but they had a desire to passionately pursue what God has for him. If you're here tonight, I don't know where you are. I don't know your past. I don't know the ins and outs of your lives. There might be some people here that are just literally running from God. You're trying everything you can to keep God at a distance. And maybe you're here out of obligation to a family member. Or maybe that's you. For whatever reason, for whatever excuse you have, you keep God at a distance. There might be some here that maybe you've been born and raised in the church and you go through the motions, but really on the inside, you're just spiritually dead. There's webs in your spiritual life, dust that is settled. Or maybe you're here tonight and you just need a reminder. Maybe life seems to be going pretty good, but you just need a reminder of how important and how incredible God's forgiveness is. Regardless of who you are, I want to let you know that God, like that prodigal son's father, is waiting with open arms for you to come home and to forgive you. I want to close with this story that I read. It's a beautiful story, and it just really illustrates God's forgiveness. There was an old English man, and he was looking for a brand new car. So he was searching the newspaper, and he came across the Rolls-Royce ad. And in big, huge, bold print, it was being advertised as the car that would never, ever break down. You would never, ever have a problem. So later on that day, he went to the Rolls-Royce dealership, and he asked the dealer about the car. He says, "You guys advertise that this car will never, ever break down. Is that true?" The Rolls-Royce dealer said, "Sure, that is absolutely true. We guarantee that this car will never, ever break down." So he says, "Good, sign me up. I'd love to have it." Paid a hefty penny for it. The next day, he's driving out in the country land, windy roads, enjoying the cool breeze, enjoying his nice car. And his car broke down. So frustrated, upset that this car that was said to not break down had broken down, got out of his car, walked to the nearest country house, called the dealer, said, "You told me this car would not break down, and this car broke down the day after I bought it." He said, "Sir, don't worry about it. We will make sure that there's a mechanic. He will be out there." The guy walked back to his car, was waiting there. Within an hour, a helicopter had come, landed right by his car. A mechanic was inside the helicopter, looked at his car, brought out his tools, found out what the problem was, fixed the car. Mechanic went back in the helicopter, took off. The guy went back on his way in his car. Weeks went by waiting for the bill. He knew it was going to be an expensive bill. They flew in the mechanic on the helicopter. This has got to be expensive. He's waiting and waiting for the bill to come. It never came. He called up the Rolls-Royce dealership and said, "I had some work done on my Rolls-Royce. I just really would like to get the bill taken care of." He said, "Sir, what is your name? And can we get what type of car it was?" They took down his address, or they took down his information. They said, "Sir, we looked through our records, and we have no record that anything ever happened to your car. Sir, your car never broke down." How beautiful God's forgiveness is. That the wrong things in our life, that when we come to him, he extends grace and remembers those things no more. And when we come to God, and we say, "God, I was broken. God, I was trouble. I was a thief. I was all these things." And God says, "I don't remember you that way. I don't remember you that way. You're my son. You're my daughter. You're not broken. How beautiful is God's forgiveness? If there's any takeaway from tonight's message, it's this. That God's forgiveness is the greatest thing that has ever happened to mankind. I cannot think of any other greater event, anything that has changed the history of this world, nor anything that can change a man's heart like the forgiveness of God. And what should our response be? It's a lifetime of pursuing Christ. That's how we show our thankfulness. So if there's anything to be thankful for, at the top of the list should be God's forgiveness. I want to challenge you, as you're sitting around your dinner tables, as you're sitting around with family and friends, take some time and consider talking about what God has done in your life. How far He has brought you. How far He has brought your kids. How far He's brought your marriage. Let this Thanksgiving be filled not only with thankfulness of the things that we have, but be filled with the things that we don't have, which is our sins, because He's forgiven us. Let's pray. God, we thank You so much. God, I ask, God, that You would be with every single one of us. God, as we are here today, a thankful people, that You even desire to be involved in our lives. God, You're so good to us. When we don't deserve it, You still pursue us. You still chase after us. God, let tomorrow be an incredible day with family, friends. And God, maybe as some tables might look different, and maybe there's an empty chair there, I pray, God, that You would be able to just fill the gaps in their heart. Fill the gaps in that family just with Your goodness. And let us be reminded of Your goodness and Your faithfulness. God, thank You for forgiving us. And we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and let's worship. Life, May they experience joy, and most importantly, may we experience the joys of your forgiveness, that we get to know who you are. God, bless these families. We thank you so much, and we ask this in Christ's name. Amen.